This is a 120 jury charge, first degree murder. Members of the jury, in this action, the state has charged the defendant, Mark Hill, with murder in the first degree. The criminal complaint alleges that during the early morning hours of July 4th, the defendant caused the death of a human being, to wit, Don Page, and that he did so with the intent to kill her. The complaint also alleges that when he committed this crime, he used a dangerous weapon. Mark Hill has entered a plea of not guilty to this charge, which means not only that the prosecution has the duty of proving each element of the offense, but also that it has the onus of doing so beyond a reasonable doubt. I will now read to you the rules of law that you must follow in considering the evidence and in reaching your verdict. The fact that I read these instructions in a certain order, however, does not suggest that some instructions are more important than the others. You are obligated to accept the law as I give it in all of these instructions and apply that law to the facts in the case, which the state has properly proved. You may consider only the evidence that I have received during this trial and the principles of law that I am going to give you in these instructions. You must reach your verdict from these alone, guided by your soundest reason and best judgment. If any member of the jury has the impression that I have an opinion as to whether the defendant is guilty or not guilty, you must disregard that impression entirely. You must decide the issues of fact solely as you view the evidence. You, the jury, are the sole judges of the facts, and I am the judge of the law only. When you go into the jury room to deliberate, you must first determine whether or not the defendant is guilty of murder in the first degree. If you are not satisfied that he is guilty of that crime, you must then decide whether or not he is guilty of reckless homicide, which is a less serious crime. Both crimes require the state to prove that Mark Hill caused the victim's death, but murder in the first degree requires the state to prove the additional fact that the defendant acted with the intent to kill. To aid you in determining which offense applies in this case, I will now define each of them. Murder in the first degree is committed by one who causes the death of another human being with intent to kill that person. Before you may find the defendant guilty of murder in the first degree, you must be satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt that the state has proved two elements. First, that Mark Hill caused the death of the victim. Second, that Mark Hill meant to kill her. The first element requires that the relation of cause and effect existed between the death of the victim and the act of Mark Hill. Before you can find the relation of cause and effect existed, you must be satisfied that the act was a substantial factor in producing her death. The second element requires that Mark Hill acted with the intent to kill Don Page. Under the criminal code, the phrase "with intent to kill" means either that the defendant had the mental purpose to take the life of a human being, or that he was aware his conduct was almost certain to cause the death of a human being, although the law requires that the defendant intended to kill, the law does not require that this intent must have existed for any particular length of time before Mark Hill committed the act. Nor does the law require that he must have reflected upon the act for an hour or even for a minute. In other words, there need not be any appreciable time between the formation of the intent to kill and the act itself. This intent, which is a key element of murder in the first degree, can be either the mental purpose to kill, or it can be an awareness that the conduct is practically certain to produce the death of another human being. This state of mind must exist previous to the act, and it must continue to exist at the time of the act itself. You must find this intent as a fact before you can pronounce Mark Hill guilty of murder in the first degree, although you cannot look into his mind to find out his intent. You can determine it from all the facts in evidence concerning this crime. You may consider any conduct or statements that indicate his state of mind. If you see fit, you may determine his intent from such conduct or statements. You are the sole judges of the facts, but keep in mind that you must not find the defendant guilty unless you are satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt that he intended to kill. In order to prove a fact, it is not necessary that the state's attorney produce a witness who saw the act and who can testify to what he or she had seen. Instead, counsel may prove a fact indirectly. This kind of proof is called circumstantial evidence. It is evidence that the witness does not base on first-hand knowledge of the facts in issue, but on knowledge of other facts from which you may draw an inference. For example, a stolen item found in a man's possession is circumstantial evidence that he stole it, even though no one saw him steal it. This kind of evidence is neither better nor worse than direct evidence, and you may give it as much weight as you believe it deserves. You should consider the closing arguments that the attorneys made, but keep in mind that their arguments are not evidence. Draw your own conclusions and your own inferences based on what you heard.